Okay. I have to. Okay. Good. We can start. I start my timer too, just to be sure. Amazing. Good morning, everybody. Morning. I'm not used to holding a microphone, so if I do this and go away, please remind me that I have to hold it close to my mouth. Thanks. Good. Title of today's talk is Advanced Patterns in RxJS and Angular Operating Heavily Dynamic User Interfaces. What's the problem? You always start with a problem, right? What I show you is not the original problem that I solved. I can't show the original application, but it is the problem is very similar and boiled down to the essence. So, in general, I had a very confused application code, and I had to refactor it to something that is working, because it was not working for almost all the time. What is the problem? The problem looks like this. We have a user interface. In this user interface, we have to manage some local state. We have some background processes, and then we have a lot of options for user interactions, a lot of different buttons and input boxes. Let me show you where I start. Give me a second to open the correct one. Okay. So, if we take a look at the app, we have two buttons, a start button and a pause button. If I click the start button, the timer is ticking. If I click the pause button, the timer pauses. This is quite okay to implement. Then we have this set to button here in this input box, and the goal would be, if I click the set to button, no matter if the timer is ticking or not, you should jump to this specific value. And as I have just a limited time today, I will not spend too much time on demonstrating the problem. I will just show you the current solution and what we try to solve. So I have a merge operator, and I merge together two buttons, the start button click, the pause button click, and whenever the start button is clicked, I map to true. Whenever the false button is clicked, I map to false. And here I have a switch map, and depending on the bool's value, I either return an interval ticking with the specified milliseconds, or I return an observable that is called never, that never emits a value and never completes. And then I update my count. So if we would start try to implement the set to button, most of us would place the set to button here. Coding with one hand is very nice. Set to and then pipe, map to this count, and update the count. But if you spend some time on this problem, you will realize it's not that easy. In fact, I spent several days to solve the problem. Of course, it was a little bit more code than this, but in general, it was a similar problem. So, let's take 5 seconds to think how we would solve this problem, and then I will go on with slides, and later on we'll solve it with the final solution. Okay. Other ticker. Back to the presentation. My name is Michael Latke. We can stick with Michael or Michael because Latke is not that easy to spell, read, or write, so take it easy. I'm Michael. I do trainings, consultings, and this stuff on Angular, RxJS, and in general also on state management. And the first thing that I want to introduce you is reactive microarchitecture. So, what I did with the application that I refactored, I reorganized all the code base, and I call this reorganization approach the reactive microarchitecture. It is basically categorizing your reactive code, moving a lot of code away from this specific file that you try to solve, and get a better clue and overview of the problem. I created 6 different categories for my code. Constants, base observable side effects, and then also subscriptions, helpers, and custom operators. Let's start with constants, and it's pretty easy to understand what constants are. Take your time. You're done? Perfect. Okay. If you try to refactor, if you try to think what constants are, it's pretty easy. It's all the static stuff, a JSON object, a DOM element, something that you could, in best case, move into another file and store there. Second thing, we have base observables. And I subdivide base observables into 2 different groups, source observables and intermediate observables. What are intermediate observables? Well, there are 2 different things that I call intermediate observables, and there are also 2 that I call source observables. Source observables are divided into inter-action observables, which are buttons or other user interface elements, and then I have state observables. These are observables that provide me with some state that I want to observe. On the other hand, intermediate observables are a mixture of my source observables. Could be a combination of 2 user input elements, could be a combination of 2 state observables, or could be a combination of 1 state and 1 or multiple user input elements. Side effects. What are side effects? I group them into 3 different categories: user input side effects, user interface output side effects, and background processes. What are input side effects? Well, these are the things where I receive some state and I want to render this state to my view. What are output user interface output observables? Observables that are generated from button clicks, from user input elements as all kind of select options and so on. And then we have background processes. And background processes could be anything else that is running in the background, a pending HTTP request, a WebSocket that is open and sends some messages, or, as we do here, a simple tick, a simple time interval. Next category is subscriptions. How do I organize my subscriptions? Well, first, I move all my side effects from the subscribe block into a tab operator, and I store this type into a separate variable, and I be very specific with naming them. If this observable renders something in the tab operator, I call it render this and that observable. If the observable updates some state, I call it very specifically update this and that state. So I name it exactly what the side effect is doing. And in this case, I have no code in my subscription. I use the merge operator to initialize all those observables. So I don't want to merge the values with the merge operator. I just want to use the merge operator to subscribe to all of those observables and initialize them. To handle a subscription, I use the take until operator and then some observable that triggers the end or the moment when I should unsubscribe. If we are in an Angular application, we could use a subject or another stream that is triggered by the ng on destroy block. So whenever I leave the component and the component is destroyed, I will definitely want to unsubscribe to those side effects. And then I have my subscription line here, and as you can see, it is completely empty, nothing in there. This is a really good thing, and I always try to have only 1 subscription per file, and the subscription is empty in best case. As we are in Angular, there is another thing that we can use to handle our subscription. This is called the async pipe. So if we use the async pipe, we also can get rid of this single line here that tells us that we subscribe to an observable. This is the way how I handle my subscriptions. What are helper functions? Well, all types of functions that are not directly related to my code, but I use them a lot in my files, and I, in most of the cases, am able to move them into a separate file. You could name it utils or whatever you want. And of course, if we work a lot with Rx, we have a lot of custom operators. I group them into static methods in creation functions and in operator functions. And what I do is, for every single creation method or operator, I create a separate file, and I only hold one operator per file. And then I organize the rest over a barrel file, index.ts. Very good. These are six categories where I group all my code. So the first thing that I did is I opened the file, introduced those categories, and reorganized the code. But this didn't solve the problem. So I spent some time to read for different things in the internet, and I started to read also stuff from the backend. And I ran into two different things that I want to explain to you today. The first thing that I found very interesting was a concept or an architecture that is called event sourcing. It's an architecture from the backend. What is event sourcing? I have no clue. Whenever I have no clue, I ask smarter people, which I do all the time. I asked Martin Fowler, and he said, event sourcing is capturing all changes to an application state in a sequence of immutable events. Sounds interesting, right? What does it mean? Well, this sequence of immutable events could be, for example, your bank account. You add some money to your bank account, you add another amount of money to your bank account, then you withdraw something, then you again withdraw something. And if you want to know how much money you own, you just replay all those events, sum up the positive and negative numbers, and in the end you know the amount of money that is on your bank account. Does it make sense? I guess yes. Why is this cool? Well, this is a way to have a fully reproducible state. Think about it. What we do normally is we work with relational databases, and if we work with relational databases, we mutate the state all the time. With every transaction, we mutate the state of the database. And if we would want to have a fully reproducible state, we would have to make a snapshot for every single transaction of the whole database. It's a lot. And now compare it to event sourcing. What I do is I store every transaction as an event, and if I want to reproduce a state, I just replay all the actions until a certain point in time. And with this, I can know everything, or I can go back in time and say, what was my bank account 2 days ago? What was my bank account a week ago? And I will always be able to fully reproduce the state. So this is the concept of event sourcing. I ran into another interesting concept. It's called command query segregation responsibility. Pretty nerdy headline. It's not that nerdy. Let me explain it. I have no clue. I ask Bertrand Meyer. He says, event sourcing is every method should either be a command or a query, but not both. And when I read this sentence, it clicked. And I had the first idea of how I could solve my problem, because I realized that I was not able to solve it because I tried to read and write in the same snippet of code. Maybe let me talk a little bit more in detail. What is CQRS? It is segregating your application's responsibility into two things, into commands and into queries. Commands are events that I send to my backend and say, hey, please update my bank account, please add or withdraw some money. And the queries are the question to the backend, how much money do I own? What's on my bank account? And I separate those two things. In the backend, what you could do is you can solve a decade-old discussion. I'm not sure how many of you ever had this discussion, but at least some of you, I guess. If you start a greenfield project, you maybe start to think, should we go with a relational database and have fast writes, or should we go with an object-oriented database and have very fast reads? Well, with this architecture, you can have both. The only downside of this architecture is it pushes a little bit more load and work on the backend, but we as front-end developer don't care that much, right? Why I will use it? I will use it in the front-end to segregate between reading and writing from parts of my component state. Let me quickly check. Perfect. Okay. I read a lot, I had a clue, I had an idea, and then I started to solve the problem. And there's another architecture thing that I want to introduce you. It's called reactive macro architecture. It's like the bigger architecture. The first one was for one single file, this is for a whole application. This is where we started from, right? A component with all the code inside, all the mess inside, the template, the user interface, interactions, everything. And the first thing that I did is I created a display-only component. I created a component that only holds input and output bindings. Let me quickly show you that this display component is nearly completely empty. The only thing that is visible is a list of output bindings and one input binding that provides me with the state. It's here. What is the second thing that I did? I said, okay, we have this container and display component approach. The display component is only here to display stuff. The container component is only here to manage its display components and to forward state to its display components, but my state management logic inside is not really very related to this, so I created another service, a facet service for this component, where I move all the logic in that is not directly here to forward state to a specific part of my container component. And if we take a look at the code now, we see that our container component is completely empty. The only thing that is inside is my facet. 10 minutes? I have 40 minutes time, right? Here it's 18 minutes. There's something wrong. But okay, 10 minutes. Good. Let's speed up a bit. What I'm trying to tell you is that time sometimes runs faster and slower. That's the way it goes in life. And what I will do now is I will directly switch to the code and start to code, okay? And I will use this mic stand here. Amazing. Can you hear me? Test 1, 2. Okay. Good. Okay. What is the first thing? The first thing is I will implement event sourcing. So I need a sequence of events from different sources. I use the merge operator to group my start button. And for every event, for example, for the start button event, I map those events to specific commands. Is ticking is my first command and I want to set the is ticking state to true. I could do the same for the pause button. I can say whenever the pause button is clicked, I want to set is ticking to false. Okay. If we are smart, we test our code regularly. So let me test it quickly. I open the browser, the page refreshes, and when I click the start button, I should see the start command. It's showing up here. Let me zoom in. And maybe let's switch to an incognito browser because I have some plugins that produces red lines. Okay, if I click the start button, I see is ticking true. If I click the pause button, I see is ticking false. Let me do this with the rest of all the commands, of all the buttons from my user interface. And as I want to save a little bit of time, I just copy them. Okay, I inserted a lot of different buttons. Now we should be able to see all the different commands. Start, pause, set to. I could use some other numbers. I can count up and I can count down. And all the different commands show up. We can imagine that if I apply a share replay operator, that we could be able to store all those values and later on replay all the values when I subscribe on a later point in time. As I have, I don't know how much time, it's a bit confusing for me, but as I have not that much time, I believe, I will directly go over to the counter state. So this is a very primitive way of implementing event sourcing, a list of events that I can store somewhere and replay. How can I use those list of events and aggregate a state out of it? I have an initial counter state here. This is an object. If we take a quick look at this object, I have is ticking false, count zero, count up, tick speed, and count diff. These are the different things that I need to manage. And if I scroll down here, I could say, okay, my counter state is starting with all my count commands. And when I have my counter commands, I can say, use the scan operator, and the scan operator takes a function, and here another spot for an initial value. I will just leave the initial value empty and I say, okay, scan operator, you will receive an accumulator and the next item. And then you can aggregate the accumulator in some way. To make it a little bit more clear what I do is, I will rename accumulator to state. And I will rename item to command. And what I then return is a new object that contains the whole, all the values from my state, plus I will overwrite a specific slice of the state with the information that is stored in my command that I receive. Like that. State and command. And it is red for some reason. Let's ignore it for for now. And let's add another line that is called share replay. So whenever somebody, no matter at which point in time, comes to my app and tries to subscribe, he will receive the last state and also all the future states. And of course, we have to start somewhere. I will use the start with operator to start with my initial counter state. So now we have an initial value, which is at the first run this time, and then we have the commands that I will receive from my command stream to merge my command with my state, and then I replay it. let's test if this is working. I go here, I subscribe to it. So what I should see now is a first emission with the initial state. And then, let me switch to this tab, and then for every button click, I can change the state. If I click start, is ticking will change to true. If I click pause, is ticking changes to false. If I click count up or count down, I can change other values. I can also use the set to button to jump to a specific number, which is here. Or I can use the reset button to reset everything to the initial state. So in 5 lines of code, I introduced event sourcing and I accumulate the state. And now I have a way to read on a separate channel and write on a separate channel. I can write over my command stream and I can read over my state stream. So I can read from counter state and I can write over counter command. Okay, now let's implement the solution for the previous problem. First, I want to pull out the state for is ticking. I say counter state, give me from all your states the state dot is ticking. And then as I try to save some time, save some events, I only want to emit something if the value changes. There is an operator that is called distinct until change. And as long as I emit the same value here, it will not pass this operator. When the value changes to the previous one, it will pass this operator. I do the same thing for my tick speed. I say the tick speed observable is my full state, and from my full state I pull out the tick speed and I again use the distinct until changed operator to forward it only if it is ticking. Very good. Now I have all information that is needed to set up my tick interval, the previous logic that I had before. I start with is ticking. I apply a pipe, I say, whenever the new tick state arrives, I want to switch to a new value. Depending on is ticking, I will either return a timer that immediately starts and then ticks within, let's say, every second, or I return an empty or never observable to pause the stream. So this is the tick interval that could be started and stopped over my buttons over the state from is ticking. Now let me implement the command and solve the whole problem. Now I have 10 minutes. Amazing. So this time was right. Okay, so we have a little bit more time. You want to hear a joke? No? Okay. It's cool, and I can relax. That is makes stuff easier. Okay, so if you have that more time, let me test if the tick is working. I subscribe to the tick interval, and if I now click start, I should see a number that is incrementing. Perfect. Amazing. If I now click pause, the tick pauses. If I now click start, the tick starts again from zero, but I don't care about the numbers. So it's the same logic as before, but just a little bit more organized. Good. This is my tick interval. And this is definitely an intermediate observable. Now let me create the side effect. Starting from my tick interval, or interval tick, however you want to call it, I say, okay, whenever I receive the new trigger, I want to calculate the next count value. So I need the previous counter state and then increment it by one or another dynamic number. How do I get the last state from my counter component? Well, we have this observable here that is called counter state, right? So here is the state, and I get the last value into this stream by using an operator that is called with latest from. So whenever the tick ticks, and there is a last value from this stream that I call counter state observable, I will combine those two values and forward them. But instead of forwarding both values, I will use a small projection function and I say, I don't care about the tick value, I only care about the state, so I only forward the state. Very cool. So if I implement a console log here, I should be able to see my state whenever the tick is ticking. Let me quickly check this. And now I should see the state. Bam, amazing. And here is my state. That's very good. Everything is working. Now I'm able to calculate the new count. Const new count. State dot count plus state dot count diff. And we have these buttons here that say count up or count down. So in best case, I can increment or decrement the value. So let me multiply the count diff by either a positive or a negative one to get it negative or a positive number, depending on what my state says. And my state says state dot count up. Are you true? Yes, then multiply it by one. If you are false, then multiply it by minus one. And this should give me the new number that I want to apply to my state. Let me quickly test this, like this. Okay. Oh, there is a bug, because this is not an asterisk, this is a colon. If I go back, the bug is gone. Thanks, demo gods. Okay, I start, new count is one. I could count down, new count would be minus one. I could increment by 10, new count would be 10. So this calculation is working on the tick, right? Very cool. Now we have only one small problem. Or maybe not a small, but a big problem. Because we can map every single user interface part to a comment, but we are not able to map a programmatic comment here. And this is definitely something that is programmatic, right? How do I get a value from another stream into this merge operator? I could take this stream itself, move it into the merge part, maybe wrap some defer around it, but this is not the best solution. Let's make it a little bit more flexible and generic. Let's introduce a subject. I call it programmatic command subject, and it's a very simple subject, no special type of subject. And then I use this subject, and with the dot as observable method, I pull out only the observable part of this subject and apply it to all the other commands here. And then I can use the observer part of the subject, and I go here and I say this programmatic subject dot next, and now I'm able to create a new command and send the new command to all my other commands. New count, count, new count. So new count is the value of my count. I could shorten it a little bit. I could rename this variable here to just count, place it directly here, easy. That's my new command. Let's comment out this line, save it, and go here and test it. I click start, and it is nearly working perfectly. We see it is ticking two times, so I guess I have two subscriptions somewhere. Let me quickly check where I am. Counter comment from tick. Ah, here. Delete, save, go back. Ha. Okay, so the first problem is solved. The rest is only implementing features. What we did so far is, let me quickly sum up in the slides. What we did so far is we went from, yeah, a container and display component approach, introduced a facet service, moved all the crappy logic into a facet service, and then started to refactor all the code in the facet service. What we did is, we first created a method where we can map user interface interactions or ticks from the background process to a command. And then we used those commands to change the state. And later on, we can forward the state back to our user interface. If you want to be really clean, you introduce another service that takes away all those merging and aggregating of the state. And this is what we did so far. And what we have now is a fully reactive and very, very flexible and scalable architecture. To demonstrate one more feature and how flexible it is, I want to introduce one more line of code or one more feature. I want to make the tick dynamic, because the numbers are here, the count up and count down is already working. I could also increment by 10 or 20 or whatever, but the tick speed is always the same. So where should we try to solve it? Yeah. Here is my tick, and what I would need is, I would need the value from the tick speed. Whenever one of those two values changes, either the is ticking true or false, or the tick speed, I want to recalculate and reinitialize a new tick. I use an operator that is called combine latest, and please ignore the line, the stroke through line. This is just a problem with WebStorm. I definitely imported the right method. This method is not deprecated, but for some reason it shows it as deprecated, so please ignore it. Okay, now we will receive not a single value, but we will receive an array of two values. We will receive an array of the isTicking value and of the tick speed. And now I can use this tick speed here, and it was one single line of code, and we have a dynamic tick. If it recompiles, oh, looks good, we can start the timer. I can now increment or decrement the number, count up or count down, and I could also change the speed. I could say tick faster or tick slower. And in the same way, I could add an infinite number of features, and it is definitely well scalable. Perfect. To end this presentation, I have one last slide that I want to talk about. I want to talk about performance optimization. And here I have six blocks. The first and most important thing that you should know, if you want to optimize for performance, do it at the end of your project. Don't start with it, please. First, make it nice, working, then make it nice. Second, we can switch to change detection on push. We can work with the async pipe to reduce the number of executions of our input bindings. We could use the animation frame to schedule frequently the events that are rendered in my DOM over the animation frame. We could also debounce user interaction or sample user interaction, and very rare cases, but they exist, if we work with huge set of arrays, you can switch to RxJS operators. Otherwise, please stick with the array-first class functions, because they are way more performant than the Rx operators. Good. Let's sum it up. We learned how to categorize our code, move a lot of code into separate files, organize it. This was called the reactive microarchitecture. We also learned about the reactive macroarchitecture. We know where to move code in an Angular application. We know that we have a container component, display component, a facet to manage the local state. And if you ask where is my global state management and where to combine it, this will be part of the next presentation that I'm currently working on. But in your container component, you could retrieve state from, for example, NGRX or any other Redux implementation and combine it with your local state management. This approach that I used, as well as the Redux thing, both of them are heavily influenced by CQRS and event sourcing. These are the two architectures that I introduced here in the frontend that are originated in the backend. We learned about this stuff, and we now know that if we try to think outside of the box, most of the time we can benefit from it. As I take a look at the time, I'm perfectly in time. I can have 5 more seconds to introduce my marble design system. This is a new standard to draw marble diagrams for reactive programming. If you're interested, if you want to open up issues or something else, please picture this link, open it, and give me some comments about your thoughts on it. And that's it. Thanks for your time. If you have any more questions, I'm here the rest of the day.